Coming up on this episode of Swing Nation, a new children's book for Lindy Hoppers, dancers learning to play jazz music, and some West Virginian dancers enter a dance music video contest. Swing Nation episode 52 starts now.
Hit that jive, close the door, get the carpet off the floor, Swing Nation.
People grooving together.
Truck on down, pimp your stroll, put some jelly on that roll, Swing Nation.
People grooving together.
Hey, welcome to Swing Nation episode 52 for April the 23rd. We're so happy you joined us. I am one of your hosts, Rick O'Matic. We are joined, as always, by Spuds and
for the first time.
For the first time ever.
The first time on the program.
Nirav Sanghani.
How's it going?
It's
That's
great.
Right.
Do we want to let him in on the joke or no?
Sure.
No, don't. Just go.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you for joining us here.
Yes.
Nirav is a local, you're teaching now, right?
I am teaching.
Yeah, you're teaching at the 920 special and also...
I might be. Next month.
Are they going to be watching this show and see if you're good enough to teach?
Yeah.
Okay.
That doesn't make any sense.
He also... Shut up. There's my camera. He also... We're having a good time today for this show. Competed, I remember I saw you at the International Lindy Hop Championships in 2013. At Pro-Am.
As the AM.
No, that was the year before. That was
2012. 2012. He's right. 2012. How was that? Was that spooky?
What was spooky about it?
I don't know. You tell me. Anytime I compete, I'm scared bleepless.
No. It was good. It was a lot of fun. It was my first routine competed with at ILHC, and it was stressful, but I competed with Nicole Friedman was the pro, and she was, I mean, you know, she's a calming force.
Yeah.
but no, it was great. We had a lot of fun. I was proud of what we put on the floor.
Yeah. It was really terrific. I was really proud of you guys. I was happy to send the video back to your parents.
Yeah. We were all three on the same flight back, and on the BART back from the airport, I think, to San Francisco, we were talking about how my parents got to live stream my performance because of Swing Nation.
Aww.
Just pretty awesome.
Well, before, because of Yehoodi.
Because of Yehoodi.
But that's okay. Who's... Yeah, semantics.
Because of who's
got semantics.
Who's semantics? Whatever. All right. Quick bits.
Yes.
I almost screwed that up. What did I say? I said quick bits. I almost said something else.
Wow. Okay. Alrighty. So Frankie 100, of course, right around the corner. Lots of things to do in preparation, whether you're going or not going. One of the things they really want people to do is to participate in this kind of global choreography. And in past ones, we've had sort of like global shim shams and global, I'm trying to think of some of the other things people have done. But this year, they're asking people to do the Lindy Chorus, which is...
Get out!
Yeah. No, I have to stay here. I have no show. And which is a routine that Frankie did in response to the Shim Sham, where he wanted a routine, because Shim Sham comes from tap, and he wanted a routine that was like the Shim Sham, but involved partner dancing, but you do it, like lots of people do it together. So if you don't know the Lindy Chorus, this is high time that you learned it, and if you already know it, you know, gotta brush up on it.
What are you yapping about?
You guys got your Lindy Chorus ready for Frankie 100?
I'm working on it.
Actually,
apparently you're teaching.
He's teaching.
I think I'm teaching the Lindy Chorus.
All right.
I should probably learn it.
You probably should learn it. You all should probably learn it before Frank. So basically, what you do, I think, is you film your community dancing the Lindy Chorus, then you post it online, and then it gets smooshed together into some awesome video that they're going to show at Frankie 100. We've only got like. Less than a month left, so you better get on it, folks. So that's what's happening in the world of Frankie 100. What's going on with our friends at Dance Manhattan?
Okay, so this really hurts my heart. Oh. The venue, the dance studio that I took my very first lesson at, of I think any dance ever, is in New York. It's called Dance Manhattan. And I went there with a bunch of friends. Frank Delario, actually, who's a Yehoodi co-founder, he and I went to a guest class. It was a free class for West Coast Swing. And so my first dance was actually West Coast Swing. It was like three months of West Coast Swing. And then I saw how fun Lindy Hop was. But the dance school existed for quite a while, maybe, what, 15, 20 years? Mm-hmm. And now, the place that I grew up and learned and taught at, they're getting forced to move out of their building because of rent increases. And this is a huge blow to not only, you know, the dance community, but the Lindy Hop community in New York, because there are not many dance studios that teach authentic Lindy Hop like we know it. Mm-hmm. Okay, they'll do jive and they'll do, you know, some variations of that. There's an article that showed up on dnainfo.com in New York about Dance Manhattan having to move its 1,400 square foot location at 39 West 19th Street after nearly 20 years because the landlord is doubling the rent at the end of August, and they have to go. Boy, oh boy.
Yeah.
Hmm. I don't know. The more I think about this, you're shutting down Dance Manhattan, which has more than just Lindy Hop. They have tango, salsa, hustle, merengue, tons of dances, tons of teachers, tons of people who go there. They had two floors. They had the fifth floor and the fourth floor, I think. Elena Iannucci, who is my boss and who's one of the co-founders and also with Teddy Kern of the studio, they were so welcoming and open to dancers. And the staff, they would open the ballroom up. All the rooms were free to people working there so they could work on their craft. So people like Evita and Nathan and stuff, they could go in and they could practice. And Michael, they could practice for free just so they could, you know, become better, you know, dancers. So this is a shame. Really sorry to have to give this news.
They're not closing, right?
Hopefully they won't close, but they need to find a new place, and they haven't found one yet. They need to find a place that supports all the dances and all the students. So there you go. Sucks.
Time to go to Brooklyn.
You think Dance Brooklyn?
Dance Brooklyn.
Dance Brooklyn.
Dance Manhattan in Brooklyn, I think that could happen. That's really sad news. I also did a lot of dancing at Dance Manhattan and loved that place. Another end of an era news from South Carolina. Paul Hoke wanted us to know that the Handlebar Swing Dance is closing its doors after 15 years of swinging out. It actually had a jazz funeral, which is a fine way to let out to sort of close your venue on the 15th of April. And there's a bunch of, I think, Facebook posts about it. Apparently they had people drive in for like 2 to 3 hours, someone to go to the venue. One friend flew in from Texas. And apparently it was just a really joyous kind of last celebration of this much loved venue in South Carolina. So sorry, guys. I hope you find a much better place next time.
Well, they actually have found a better place.
Oh, they have played. Oh,
yeah. Goodness. So it's one of those great stories about Paul Hoke, who kind of started this up. The Handlebar is such an important space to them and the dancers and everything that they decided to... They have to leave, but they decided to do the jazz funeral.
Yeah, yeah.
And they did a dance, like 10 o'clock. They all mournfully walked out with musicians playing. And then they bumped it into a, you know, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But they do have a new place. And it is, so, actually, if you check out CarolinaSCW.com, there's a story on there about, so you can see Paul, and there's a little interview on Carolina Now about what happened with the place. It's a shame that the Handlebar was a huge, like, it was the location, it was the go-to place for swing, and it's gone. And that happens a lot nowadays. It just seems like either the venue wants to make more money, or they don't want to make more money, and they're all about the dancers, but they get shut down because of some law, or the owner of the building is kicking them out. I mean, what are we going to do, people? How do we keep going?
Let's put on a show. I think I saw it. movie about that once.
I think that's a good idea. Anyway, congratulations to Paul and the rest of those guys. Keep it going at your new location.
Yeah. Got some feedback.
Feedback. That's the feedback song.
Yes. So I think we did a, like, even a Yehoodi talk show about this a while ago.
Maybe. Wow. A Yehoodi
right?
talk show.
Before Swing Nation, where on JibJab, the site for all sorts of silly videos, there's a swing video called Jump Jive and Something that's related to Easter. And there were, like, whenever I saw it, I was like, this has to be some real Lindy Hoppers.
Yeah.
Who are these people? So apparently Cynthia Simmons did a little bit of digging, and it is Dax and Sarah, along with Minvo and Stephanie Klausman, who are dancing in that video. And there is actually a video on now that where basically
Dax uploaded
putting their actual faces on their sort of digitized bodies. Very weird juxtaposition. I don't know if we have, so like a
we can show a little bit of it.
Okay.
Yeah. I love these jib jabs. I did one for Christmas.
Yeah.
It was pretty cool. I love how they're not really happy, though.
They're just like badass. They're so serious.
Dax, couldn't you have picked, like, faces that are smiling? Alright. I love it. It's like, it's their bodies with giant heads.
Yeah.
There you go. Jib-jab! That's how you say it. Right?
That is how you say jib-jab.
Jib-jab.
Yes. What's this about a children's book?
I am so excited
you
about
this. You have a
this.
Kid, so you should be excited.
Well, it's not because I'm a kid.
That's for you.
Oh, man, why you guys say that? I got trying to hook up some ladies on the show. No, there's this book on Lindy Hop that's coming out called Jitterbugs. And so we've got a couple of dancers, actually, who are putting together this book. And it's the story of two bugs that are completely different. One's really tall and one's really short. And how they overcome this difference through dance. And guess what? It's based off of Big B and
Shorty George.
That's right. And so when I saw this, I was like, sign me up. I want this book immediately. And I, when you jump on the page, I'm on the Jitterbugs website right now, a dance-along story inspired by real American jitterbugs.
Aww,
and
adorable.
The artwork is really super cute. Book theme celebrates uniqueness, engages kinesthetic learners in literature, promotes active play between parent and child. Hey, guess what? It's an awesome story. I can talk, like tell my kid, we can sit down and read. They're doing a fundraiser to raise money for, what are they raising money for?
To release the book.
To release the book.
Yeah. So if you want a copy of the book, the easiest way to get it is to kick in a few dollars into their Indiegogo campaign. If you go to Indiegogo and you search for Jitterbugs, by the time this show is publicly available, that Indiegogo campaign should be publicly launched. So basically, I think it's like they need not a lot of money, like $5,000. So I think they should easily be able to get that from all the Lindy Hop parents out there who would love this for their, I mean, I want a copy of it. I don't have a kid. You know? But yeah, congratulations. So if you're more interested, do we have a?
Yeah, we've got a little bit of that campaign.
Okay, cool.
And that song is Shorty George by Count Basie. Thank you.
Jitterbugs is an exciting picture book that entertains children with a scat rhythm undertone and fast-moving story about two very different bugs who triumph through their unlikely dance partnership. I've spent my dance career visiting elementary schools as a teaching artist. One dance style that changed my life is a type of swing dance called the Lindy Hop.
Yeah.
It's an important part of American history and is sometimes called the jitterbug. I've told the story of Shorty George and Big B, two real African-American dancers from the 1930s, to countless classrooms. It's my favorite story to tell when kids start saying things like, I can't dance with him, he's too short.
My favorite character in Jitterbugs is Big B, because I'm like her because I'm tall and I dance with little, like, shorter kids than me, but I still like to dance anyways.
Jitterbugs celebrates uniqueness and encourages kids to participate through movement.
All right, so congratulations to Margo and Karen for this endeavor. Please give, you know, to their quest to put out a really cute book so my kid can learn to read, please.
Wow. You went right there.
Yeah, I always go right there.
So we have our host, our guest here, Nirav, our guest co-host.
He's still here.
He's still here. Yeah. So one of the reasons we were interested in having Nirav on the show is Nirav not only is a dancer, but he also is a musician. And I guess you've been a musician for a long time, right?
Yeah, I played a bunch of stuff growing up, but never jazz music until about two years ago.
And so what has been, I guess, what have you found it has been like playing music that you love to dance to?
It's probably one of the most fulfilling things I've ever done. So I learned all of this music theory, and if any of you took, like, piano growing up or were in orchestra, you'll empathize with me. You learn all this music theory, and you never use it again because you're reading music off the page. But as soon as I started to play jazz guitar, everything started coming back, all of the circle of fifths and voice leading and chord tones and things like that. No, I'm just making words up right now, actually.
No, well, circle of fifths was good. So, no, Nirav and I, we were chatting about this at one point, because I used to...
Yeah, you're right, it was at one point.
It was at one point, yes.
A couple weeks ago.
2 point. I used to play violin.
Really?
And I was in the, yeah, I was in the Brooklyn Choir, Brooklyn Junior Orchestra, right? That was pretty bad. Actually, I was kind of good. But we learned all this... But I digress. We learned all this theory and stuff, and I never really, I was like, okay, I just read and I played. Yeah. And then later, when I picked up the ukulele, I started playing jazz on it. All that stuff, yeah, came back. And it was, do you feel that the jazz stuff is harder to play, or?
Well, in some ways, I think they, like a lot of things, you get up to the medium to higher to very advanced levels, and it's very difficult, right? Like anything else. But, on the basic levels, it's actually really accessible to play because it was pop music back in the day. It's not like it's not like modern jazz where it's like, all right, you want to play the basic song, you need to study for 5 years and then and then maybe you'll have a shot. It's like, oh, this is accessible, this is like got catchy tunes and melodies. And, you know, for someone who's played guitar for a little bit, I could learn the chords fairly easily and then start playing them. Mm. But I did have some inspiration. I think it was maybe 3 or 4 years ago at it was an event in Albuquerque. I was talking with Mike Faltasek, and he mentioned, he's like, you know, I picked up guitar like a few years ago, and he was playing the event. And he's like, you know, I just focused and did it. And I was like, I already play guitar. I could do this too. So then I picked up guitar and started working on that. And only recently we talked again about that moment. And I was like, you know, you said that, and I was telling someone else that. And then Faulty interrupted me, and he's like, yeah, they were like, oh, if that guy can do it, anyone can do it. That's not true. Like, he's a really, really dedicated person. But the idea is that, you know, even past elementary school, you can pick something up and do it. And so that sort of inspired me and got me like really going on it.
Yeah. So let's talk a little bit about Lindy Hopper's learning to play jazz. And there was this one moment where I noticed, in a Lindy Hopper's career where they love Lindy Hop, then they start to branch out. And some of them go into like tap, so they're like ridiculous tappers all the time. And some of them actually pick up an instrument. Mm-hmm. And I see people like Mike Faltasek and Andy Reid and all those guys doing the instruments. Now you're in a band, basically full of Lindy Hoppers.
Yep.
So what is that? What do you attribute to that desire to play the music now? It's just.
Well, I think the music itself is really compelling. But I think that, like a lot of things, if you're not exposed to it, you don't gain an appreciation for it. So let's say there's like pop music now. You're exposed to it just by default all the time. And it's fun to play it. And you know it's fun to play it. Some people play it, some people don't. But with jazz music, most people aren't exposed to the kind of vintage jazz that we listen to. And so it never quite gets to that point. But once you are exposed, and the dancers are a good example, you're exposed to this all the time. And not only are you exposed to it, you know how to interpret it. You understand the structure. You talk about the music a lot. Then if you've ever played an instrument before and you can get playing some jazz, it's a lot of fun because suddenly you've thought about this, you've danced this so much, and now you're creating it. And I think it's like a pretty smooth like progression there. Yeah. I think everyone in the band has been felt like it was really rewarding from the very start. They're like, oh wait, well, this is amazing. Like already a lot of fun.
So is there a danger? So we were talking about this at one point. There was a danger of venues hiring, not hiring bands, not hiring accomplished musicians, hiring like the Careless Lovers because they feel like, hey, we want to support the dancers.
Well, let's not. Shortchange the Careless Lovers who are
no definitely not own. No.
But let's say like our band we play in the park mostly, you know, we're not wouldn't call us like very good or anything like that,
right?
But I think it's a danger. I think that especially in newer scenes with less experience, you can be like, oh well, we can just get this group of dancers, they play music, let's just have them, instead of, you know, putting the effort to find a band that's professional or fly them out or bring them in or something like that. I think that's fine if you really can't afford it and you can't do it. I think live music is almost always a good thing to have. But I think that we have a responsibility to like go and find the people that do this for a living, and they've, you know, made it possible for us to dance to live music now, right? When Lindy Hoppers when people started dancing again, there were not a bunch of swing bands or a bunch of dancer bands
exactly
ready to play. We had to get the people who had been doing trad jazz for like, you know, 40 years, keeping it alive, and then they could play for us. And if they hadn't been there, what would he have done, you know? So, yeah, but now we have a wide variety. I think it's just good to, like, go to the people who are the pros, you know, and get them to do their professional thing. That's all I got.
Yes, we should hire.
I got lots more. I just didn't want to cut you off.
No, I'm good. I'm just thinking of, I mean, in terms of dangers, like, you know, I think there's lots of things to be worried about when people are thinking about like, well, what kind of jazz and who's playing the jazz, whatever. But honestly, like if you have like a plethora of people playing for dancers that are like all over the place, like that is to me an automatically a win. Unless you're in a, like, I'm trying to think of a community where it's like so saturated where there isn't opportunities for like, you know, small bars or like, you know, other smaller dances to be like, oh, I guess we actually don't have to have a DJ. We actually could have a band.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, for like just a little bit more money. Like, I think that's a net win for like lots of people, you know? And I think this sort of movement away from just like strictly DJed dance communities, like doesn't have to be that way if more people decide that they can like at least hold up like two sets even of music, which I think a lot of people could probably manage if they just brought together like four or five people and play jazz. Yay, learning instruments.
And well, I'm just going to cut in and say, since Nirav said his band is not very good or anything, oh no, you guys are getting really good really quickly.
They are getting really good. And you're not just playing in the park now. I understand there actually might be indoor places where you could see the hot baked goods.
They might let us into establishments now.
With a roof. There might be roof and walls and things like that. So if we did mention, the name of the band is The Hot Baked Goods. Can it be found on the onlines?
Yeah, thehotbakedgoods.com.
Oh, how nice. Yeah. You got that?
Yeah, we just got that.
Oh, wow.
Okay. And we stole it from the bakery.
Wow. And if one wants to see you, where would they go?
Dolores Park.
We play in Dolores Park. Check our Facebook page because we've been shifting around Saturdays and Sundays. We have more, like Rick said, indoor gigs in the work if the sun is too harsh here. It's pretty harsh.
Nice. The sun in San Francisco. So harsh.
The sun. We had some sun this weekend.
A little bit. Okay. Let's shift over to West Virginia.
Okay, see you later. Bye.
See ya. This is the sweetest email I've gotten in a long time from Amy and David Loomis. Apparently they came from SoCal and have been building up the scene in West Virginia, and they said when they arrived, people were doing the pretzel and dangerous dips to a singular CD of 90s revival songs. And now they're like bringing in authentic Lindy Hop, solo jazz, playing swing era artists, and just seeing a real increase in their community. So they're entering in this dance competition, dance video competition put on by a local GMC dealership, where they hope to win $1,000 to kind of expand their own community. So they wanted people to kind of check out their video. And if you like it, I guess you can vote on it. So maybe we can check out their video.
This is great. Oh, boy. Oh, I see. Bang, bang, bang. Now the car's going to start dancing right here.
Is it Transformer?
Oh, not yet. Not yet. Wait for it.
It's so cute.
It is cute.
Oh, so if you go to the contest, basically it's a bunch of people dancing around cars from the dealership to win $1,000. Anyway, we'll post the URL for if you want to vote for that video or any of the other videos. We just want to thank them for sending it to us, and good luck in the competition, me and David and the rest of the West Virginia swing scene.
We got a couple of minutes. We can get a couple of videos.
Oh, my gosh. There's so many good ones.
I don't know what to choose because I only watched like the first couple. What do you think? I don't think Nirav watched any of them.
Let's do... it's always good. Lithuanians are always good.
Lithuanians.
Yes.
So what is that? That's Peter.
IT. Never stop Lindy Hop.
Oh, sorry. Lindyhop.it?
The second one.
The second one? Never stop?
Or do you want to do Peter?
No, let's do Lindy Hop. Okay. Lithuanians.
You gotta love the Lithuanians.
Yeah. Oh, this is so good. Yeah.
Yeah. I like that bassist who starts out just holding it down by himself.
Yeah.
He's got it.
What is in the water over there?
Oh, man.
We keep showing Lithuanian videos.
Can't stop.
We can't stop.
It's not a big country.
Nirav, how much you want to bet that those guys playing instruments actually dance?
Oh, and all but they do.
I'm pretty sure they do.
They might dance later on.
Get out of the way. Believe in music. Oh, I believe in love. Oh, it's so good.
Almost beat it on that part. Sorry.
Watch the whole thing.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So, so good.
Oh, I do want to say one thing about the show notes. That people are worrying, where are the show notes for the show?
They're in the thing.
Well, we're going to correct this. So Rick always puts the show notes in the thread on Yehoodi, but there is a place to put show notes in the actual show on the show page. Mm-hmm. So we're just going to move all those show notes into the show page. We're going to do it over time, but you'll get the show notes.
On Justin TV?
No, not on Justin, on Yehoodi.com.
Okay.
Yeah, so currently if you go to the comment thread of the particular show, you'll see the show notes. Just want to let you know. Some people were wondering about where.
Okay, we got time for one more, dude.
Time for one note.
You
more.
Pick it.
Me?
Yeah.
Okay, and we got to do Peter and Katya. At Peter Loggins and Katya. How do you say her last name?
No idea.
I forgot.
Faster.
Yeah. Swung it out.
Yeah. I think I said it. I was just trying to clap along to the song and I had trouble.
That's a pretty big ballroom. Oh my God, that's a fast tempo.
They did the first half of the song at halftime.
Oh.
And it just keeps going, too.
Oh, man. Peter is like 60 years old.
He is that man. He's like half of America.
He's the freaking Winter Soldier.
He is the Winter Soldier. Oh.
Yes!
Bravo.
Oof. Soul clap. All right.
Soul clap. All right, that's a good one to lead off.
That's a good one.
That's a show on. Goodness.
As my son would say, that's a good one, Daddy.
Yeah, that's exactly how your son would say.
Who's taking it out?
You got it, dude.
All right, thank you so much once again for watching Swing Nation episode 52 here in San Francisco, California. You can contact us. It's real easy. It's on the email. It's news. I have to look and see what it was.
Okay,
news at Yehoodi.com. Facebook, we have a wonderful page you can check out. It is Swing Nation TV. I'm getting Zucker Punch disease right now, forgetting the same thing we do every week. On the Twitters, we are at Yehoodi, at Spuds, at Zucker Punch, at Rick-O-Matic, and you are?
At I am Nirav.
At I am Nirav. Nirav. Nirav.
Nirav.
Nirav.
Thanks.
Nirav. And someone's heckling us right now on Skype. and call us 201-984-7469, 201-94-SHOW, leave a message. I want to say once again, thank you so much. Oh, yeah, and rate us on iTunes. Once again, thank you so much, Nirav, for coming in.
Yeah.
Anytime.
All the time.
The first time is better than the second time.
Sometimes the first time. boy.
Yeah. Thanks a lot for watching. Come to Dolores Park, check out the hot baked goods, and we will see you guys next time.
See ya.
I'm gonna do this. Coming up on this episode of Swing Nation, a new children's book for Lindy Hoppers, dancers learning to play jazz music, and some West Virginian dancers.
Wow!
Is that?
No!
West Virginia dancers are not f***ing!
West Virginia's for lovers! We're going with that one.